So in 2 Samuel 15, there's a revolt that takes place after being reconciled to his father. Absalom began preparing a revolt against him. Now, Absalom was extremely handsome. Chapter 14, verse 25. And he had fast-growing, thick hair. Chapter 14, 26. So he had the charisma. He had the looks. He had, you know, people just easily bought into him. Absalom, though, personified everything that God hates. And you read about what God hates in Proverbs chapter 6, verse 16 through 19. And so there, besides 2 Samuel 15, put Absalom personified Proverbs chapter 6, verse 16 through 19. And that'll preach for you, teach for you. Of course, many of the Israelite people were deceived by him and believed his flattery and lies. Some things never change, do they? They should have remained loyal to the Lord and to David, but recall what the crowd did to the son of David and the Lord Jesus Christ. It's been said that a crisis reveals who our loyal friends really are. Okay? So a crisis, when things are really down, maybe you've even messed up. Who was just there for you? Who was just there really for themselves? There for you because of themselves, or who's there with you and really for you? David's servants were ready to obey, verse 15, and ready to die, verse 21. So, that's important to have people in your life like that. Absalom was a deceiver. He built himself up by parading around in a beautiful horse-drawn chariot and hiring 50 men to run ahead of him. 15, verse 1. He stood by the road leading to the main gate in Jerusalem, met the people, listened to their needs, and stole their hearts. 15, verse 2 through 6. After a four-year period of preparation, Absalom went to the city of Hebron, blew a trumpet, and declared a revolt against his father. Can you imagine? You've probably been through some rough times in life. Could you imagine your own child turning on you? Chapter 15, verse 13 through 17. There came a messenger, verse 13, to David saying, "The hearts of men of Israel are after Absalom." You know, they have fallen for Absalom. And even in our day and time, we've seen that sort of take place. And really not much you can say. It's really not much you can do. Even when you have the facts before on people, still follow, okay? And, 7 years ago, it was a disaster for our country because of a similar thing. The sad part is how the morals and the biblical view and the godly values of things have changed. And sadly, many church-going people has allowed it and bought into it, compromise what they once stood, just to support somebody. Because like David's son here, he stole their heart. Okay. So this happens over and over. It happens in business too. King went forth and all his household after him. The king left 10 women, which were concubines, to keep the house. Verse 16, the edge of the city, David suddenly noticed that his foreign friend Ittai, who had been visiting Jerusalem from the Philistine city of Gath was accompanying the king along with 600 Gittite warriors who served under him. David, what are you doing here? Go on back with your men, for you are a guest in Israel. Should I force you to wander with me? Go on back, and may the Lord be merciful to you. Ittai's answer, as the Lord liveth, and as my Lord the king liveth, surely in what place my Lord the king shall be, whether in death or life, even there also will thy servant be. Verse 21. When you find somebody worthy of following and somebody that's anointed by God, then you should support them all the way. David was a man of prayer. He also used wise strategy. Ahithophel abandoned David and joined the rebellion. But he was Bathsheba's grandfather. Wow, some more drama, some more family dynamics. So he took the opportunity for revenge. Bitterness kept gnawing at him. During the time of Absalom's rebellion, okay, so 2 Samuel 15, you want to write down these Psalms. Okay, 2 Samuel 15, Absalom's rebellion against his daddy. Psalm 3 and 4. Psalm 39, Psalm 41, Psalm 55, 61, 62, and 63, and Psalm 143. So God's still working, even in drama, even in bad family dynamics, and all that. David went up by the ascent of Mount Olivet and wept as he went up and had his head covered, and he went barefoot, and all the people that was with him covered every man his head, and they went up weeping as they went up. There, verse 30. Verse 24 through 29, you can read there. Chapter 15, verse 31 through 37. Then chapter 16, 15 through 17, 23. Upon learning that his former advisor Ahithophel had joined Absalom's revolt, David ordered another loyal advisor, Hushai, to pretend to sell out to Absalom also, that he might frustrate and counter Ahithophel's counsel. So this plan worked exactly as David had hoped it would. And the vain Absalom decides upon Hushai's counsel, thus unknowingly allowing David time to mobilize his troops. Upon having his advice refused, Ahithophel went home and hanged himself. Chapter 17, verse 23. Ahithophel was closely associated with David. He betrayed David and later hanged himself. Judas in the New Testament was closely associated with the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of David. He betrayed the Son of David and later did what? Hanged himself. During the interval before the battle, David met with several individuals. Chapter 16, Ziba. Ziba slanders his master, saying Mephibosheth was in Jerusalem hoping David would be defeated so he could get back his grandfather Saul's kingdom. David seemed to believe Ziba and gave him the estate he had previously awarded to Mephibosheth. Later, however, the king would refuse this. Some meetings in chapter 17, 27 through 29, three men, all non-Israelite friends of David, met the king and brought him mats to sleep on. cooking pots, serving bowls, wheat and barley, flour, parched grain, beans, lentils, honey, butter, and cheese. We have to survive, don't we? We have to eat. Even our physical, it's there with friends to take, helping physically. Chapter 16, verse 5 through 13, member of Saul's family encountered David, hurled by curses and rocks at the king. Okay, so again, just look at all this, man. You think, man, this person's mad at this person can't get along with that person, and you know, it just goes on and on. And it's been like that, you know, in time. Chapter 18, David's seasoned troops met Absalom's inexperienced soldiers at the Battle of Mount Ephraim. David, of course, is concerned about his son, verse 5. And the king commanded Joab and Abishai and Ittai, saying, deal gently for my sake with the young man, even with Absalom. And all the people heard when the king gave all the captains charge concerning Absalom. All right, so he wants to win, but he won't take it easy on my boy. Even though his boys tried to do all this. And fleeing from the battle on his mule, Absalom's head was caught by the thick branches of a large oak tree, leaving him hanging in midair. Verse 9. Joab found and killed him by plunging three javelins in his heart. And verse 14. His lifeless body was then thrown in a forest pit and covered by some rocks. Verse 16. He was not buried in the pillar he had previously prepared for himself in the king's valley in Jerusalem. Verse 18. So David's anguish, and you get the depths of this anguish. Verse 33, and the king was much moved and went up to the chamber over the gate and wept. And as he went, thus he said, oh, my son Absalom, my son, my son, my son Absalom, with God I had died for thee, oh, Absalom, my son, my son. You've probably been in a point of despair like that. Over someone. Joab came into the house to the king and said, thou hast shamed this day the faces of all thy servants which this day have saved thy life and the lives of thy sons and thy daughters and the lives of thy wives and the lives of thy concubines. Hey, we would fall for thee. And, you know, this is found in chapter 19, verse 5 through 7. David and Zadok in chapter 19, verse 8 through 43. Zadok and Abiathar, the priests, were sent to the elders in Judah that they might create some interest for the king's return. It seemed all the other tribes except his own wanted this to happen. And so you just read some different stories there. Chapter 19, verse 8 through chapter 20, verse 6. At long last, eventually David had returned home, but two more bloody events would occur before peaceful conditions prevailed. The murder of Amasa, chapter 20, verse 4 through 10. And then the malcontent of Sheba, in chapter 20, verse 1 through 3, and verse 14 through 22 there for that. So events create opportunities, and people use opportunities in different ways. Sheba saw the tribal conflict as an opportunity for promoting himself. Isn't that something? People try to take advantage of other people's difficulties or try to take advantage of other people's turmoil. He saw the tribal conflict as this opportunity. Because he was a Benjamite, he hoped to get broad support from Saul's friends and David's enemies, and he almost succeeded. Once again, the people deserted God's chosen king for someone who was trying to be opportunistic. And Amasa was chosen to lead David's army to victory, but he delayed and lost his opportunity for greatness. However, Joab seized the opportunity, removed his replacement, won the battle, and got his job back. Joab had murdered Abner, Absalom, and Amasa, yet David apparently did nothing to discipline him. Perhaps Joab knew too much about David. That happens in the political arena, and that happens in government arena. Okay, and you gonna tell that on me? Well, I'm gonna tell this on you. Sad, isn't it? Oh man, sinners, people. All those battles and all that trouble. Chad brings us to chapter 21. There was a famine that lasted for 3 years, and David spent much time in prayer about it. Finally, God told him the famine was a divine judgment upon Israel because of the sins they had in the past committed against the Gibeonites. In Joshua 9, Israel had made a covenant with these pagan people that they would not be harmed, but Saul and his family had murdered many of them. God's a God of his word, and he expects us to keep our word. Okay? It takes it very serious when we don't. He solved the problem. David negotiated with the Gibeonite leaders, and they determined that justice could only be done by allowing them to execute 7 of Saul's sons, all of whom doubtlessly participated in the former Gibeon massacre. So they're not people that were not guilty of anything, okay? I'll turn them over to you. Okay, they were part of the process, okay? So they were guilty. So justice was being done, taking place here. This was done and the plague was stayed. Life of Mephibosheth was, however, spared. Later, David ordered a decent burial to be given to 2 of these sons upon learning that their mother had watched over their bodies during the entire harvest season, driving away the vultures and wild animals. David, chapter 24, commanded Joab, his military commander, to conduct a census throughout the land that he might know the population of Israel. Satan was behind this. 1 Chronicles 21:1 says, "And Satan stood up against Israel and provoked David to number Israel." So see how you take scripture here and you get scripture elsewhere and you get the full story. And so 1 Chronicles 21, Satan was behind this. Normally this would not have been wrong, but for some unrecorded reason, God had apparently forbidden David to count his troops at this time. But David, perhaps acting out of pride or lack of faith in God to protect Israel, had disobeyed. And I think that's exactly what it is. Pride. Look at my kingdom. And then lack of faith in God. Okay, do we have what's necessary to get the job done? Do we have what's, rather than get as close to God and trust God and rely on God? So Joab objects to the project, but David insists to be carried out. At the end of 9 months and 20 days, Joab gives David the figures in verse 9. Soon David realized the census was highly displeasing to God. Verse 10, "And David's heart smote him after that he had numbered the people. And David said unto the Lord, I have sinned greatly in that I have done. And now I beseech thee, O Lord, take away the iniquity of thy servant, for I have done very foolishly." God allowed David to choose from one of 3 possibilities what his punishment would be: a period of famine, flee 90 days before his enemies, a 3-day pestilence. David chose the 3rd, a 3-day pestilence. David said unto Gad, "I am in a great strait. Let us fall now into the land of the Lord, for his mercies are great, and let me not fall into the hand of man." So the Lord sent a pestilence upon Israel from the morning even to the time appointed and there died of the people from Dan even to Beersheba 70,000 men. What do you think about when you read something like this in the Bible? See how a leader can, and the decisions of one person can cause the death of so many. And it happens today, doesn't it? I mean, maybe troops ordered into a bad battle that they, or a war, you know, are led into it and not led good. Or, you know, so our decisions has consequences on upon other people. When the angel, verse 16, when the angel stretched out his hand upon Israel, upon Jerusalem to destroy it, the Lord repented him of the evil and said to the angel that destroyed the people, it is enough. Stay now thy hand. And the angel of the Lord was by the threshing place of Arunah, the Jebusite. David was commanded to build an altar at the place where the plague stopped. This he did, but not before buying the threshing floor and calling it Ornan. It was upon this spot where Abraham had once offered Isaac. Here, so chapter 24. Here, as we read this story, it's very important because back in Genesis 22:2, Abraham had once offered Isaac. And where the Temple of Solomon would later be built. 2 Chronicles 3:1. You want to write that down here too. God approved of David's offering by sending down fire from heaven to consume the sacrifice. So, stubborn heart. David numbered the people. And David's sin was a sin of the will. So God asked him to make some decisions. David had a shepherd's heart and longed to deliver his people. Verses 15 through 17. And so David had to watch people that he loved suffer. And that's harder than you suffering yourself. Verse 18 through 25. David did not take the easy way out. His repentance was sincere, and he paid the full price to prove it. God has paid for our God has sacrificed and paid for our sins. Solomon built the temple on the property that David purchased for his altar. Solomon was the son of Bathsheba. And so this really gets amazing here. And the amazing grace of God. That God would take David's two great sins and build a temple out of it. So I think sometimes we have a different picture of things, and maybe we say, boy, God cannot use that. God cannot do nothing with that. But the grace of God always takes sin, always takes what's wrong, and he makes it right. He makes it right. As I've said before, a place where your ad used to be, God turned this place into he took it from a partying room to his room. To teach, so people the word of God. So that's the same way God does that. Okay, God can take the vilest of families and turn them into his family. Okay, corrupt, one of the most corrupt people and turn them into one of the most godly people. That's the grace of God. God's always doing this. He's always doing this throughout history. He's working today. He's still working in this way. He's still moving in hearts, still changing people. He's still redeeming people. Okay? And we thank God that He does, and that He cares, and that He loves us so much. Okay? So let's just begin to give an introduction now of 1 Kings. The building of Israel's first temple is the good news. The breakup of Israel's 12 tribes is the bad news that we're going to read about. So God wouldn't let David build the temple, but He's going to let Solomon build it. Remember, David couldn't because he was a man of war, a man of blood. Okay. Now, Solomon's a peaceful guy, but that's why balance is good in all things. Whatever we do, whoever we are, we need a balance, okay? If you notice, a group of people will often go entirely different way than they went before. Whether it's a presidential race or whether it's in selecting a pastor for their church or whatever. The characteristics of one person, okay, when that person goes away, they usually get somebody with totally opposite characteristics, okay, that they're looking for. We see this, okay. So David's more of we could say a calmer type of person, but that's not gonna make him more spiritual. David, okay, because what happens there, though David might take the harsh route and be very strong-handed, and that's needed, then Solomon sometimes would take the weak approach, okay, so could get a balance between these two. The overseer of the first temple was the world's wisest man and one of the richest men who ever lived. And so we learn about this in 1 Kings that Solomon was this person. Solomon's reign was the high tower mark of Israel's kingdom in the Old Testament. He controlled more than 60,000 square miles, some 10 times the size of David's dominion. Three Old Testament books of Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and the Song of Solomon were written during this time. So, see how it's important to know. So, during Solomon, okay, we have Proverbs, not only during his reign, 1 Kings is going to talk about it, but we have Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and the Song of Solomon. And, temple begun in 968 BC, lasted nearly four centuries. It was destroyed by a Babylonian monarch Nebuchadnezzar in 586 BC. So as we continue, see how one name connects with another name in the Bible in the Old Testament. Eventually we're going to get to Nebuchadnezzar, who is going to destroy this. Okay. So Solomon was wise. He asked God, when given the opportunity, he asked God for a good thing. God blessed him for that. God blessed him in wealth. Okay. Just know this, there's a lot of evil people that are rich. There's godly people that are rich. There's evil people that are poor. There's godly people that are poor. Okay? It's always been, it's always will be. Solomon was wealthy. He had a love for wealth, though. And for women. For pomp. Power. And these things weakened the unity among the 12 tribes. Upon Solomon's death, the northern ten split from the southern two in a tragic civil war. That's very important because it's not so. It's important what happens while you're someone where, while you're there, while you're living, while you're part of this company, while you're part of this family, the things that happen there. But then what happens after you're gone? If everything falls apart after you're gone, then that's not good. Neither, okay? So you want things to be better. If you leave, you want to put people in a position that it would be even stronger because now a bad leader or something could follow you or not make godly decisions that would bring it down. But hopefully you have someone trained. Paul was like this in the New Testament. He would plant, God would plant a church using Paul. Paul would train somebody, turn it over to him. Okay, he took the Apostle Paul in the New Testament understood this concept. But we can love the wrong things, and it can cause trouble. In 1 Kings 12, we find described this uniting of Israel's 12 tribes. In Revelation 7, we find described the future uniting of Israel's 12 tribes. God hasn't forgotten his people. In Scripture, there are four key periods in which many miracles were performed. The book of 1 Kings marks the beginning of the second period. During Moses and Joshua's day, Elijah and Elisha, Daniel and Ezekiel, and Christ and his apostles. Also, we read about it in the end time during the time of Revelation. The book records the first of eight bodily resurrections from the dead. Christ's glorious resurrection stands alone to these resurrection. Definitely a class entirely by itself. But you have the resurrection of a dead boy by Elijah, widow of Zarephath's son, in 1 Kings. Resurrection of a dead boy by Elisha, the Shunammite woman's son, 2 Kings 4. And then the resurrection of a dead man by Elisha, 2 Kings 13:21. And then, of course, in the New Testament, you have resurrections. But there's one resurrection that stands alone. See, all these, think about it this way. All these people that was resurrected, something happened to them in their life again. They died again. Jesus didn't die again. Okay. The book of 1 Kings also describes the first of three bloody and brutal women in the Bible. 1 Kings 21, Jezebel. And even the New Testament talks about Jezebel and the spirit. There's a spirit of Jezebel. Okay. And, if you've done any study on that research, you want to talk about that next week, that'd be good. There's a spirit of Jezebel. And a lot of churches are hit with that spirit, I think. Ahithaliah and Herodias. In 2 Kings 11, we read about 2 and then Herodias in Matthew chapter 14. Elijah's contest on Mount Carmel, we're going to see that, marks the second of Scripture's two greatest demonstrations showing the power of the true God as opposed to that of the false gods. The ten plagues in Moses' day were history's first such demonstration. So when we get to 1 Kings 18, that's pretty exciting there. The book of 1 Kings is quoted from or alluded to 53 times by 9 New Testament books. It is the 12th largest Old Testament book and 13th longest biblical book, with 22 chapters, 862 verses, and 24,524 words. The book covers a span of 118 years, from 971 to 853 B.C. Okay, 1 Kings. Kings. Just give you overview of 2 Kings. The Syrians are coming. The Babylonians are coming. The book of 2 Kings records both these events. The first resulting in the capture of the northern kingdom, and the second in Judah's destruction. Chapter 22 of 2 Kings is a powerful chapter. You'll like that. It was discovering the days of Josiah of the Word of God. They discovered the Word of God, man. And boy, if people would rediscover the Word of God in our country, man, we could see revival, just like they saw revival. The destruction in the days of Zedekiah of the Temple of God, chapter 25. The only Old Testament man ever to be healed of leprosy, Naaman, chapter 5. The salvation of Samaria by four lepers, and of Jerusalem by the death angel, chapter 6 and 19. The beginning of the Samaritan race, chapter 17. So that's important. 2 Kings, the Samaritan race. They're going to be talked about during, when we get to the gospel, when you see the gospels and Jesus and the Samaritans, okay? And the Jew, okay? The Jew wasn't too fond of the Samaritans, okay? And Jesus egged it on with his own brothers, in the sense of being born a Jew himself, and telling stories of how they were the heroes and his countrymen were not, how he ministered to them. So some pretty interesting stuff there. So chapter 17 is important. The second and third of three occasions when God rolled back the waters of the Jordan River. The sight of an axe head floating on water, chapter 6. You ever visit Boots brother Sam, they might ask you that question, so you might know that one. Anyway, yeah, that's found in 2 Kings chapter 6. Hey, by surprise. The last of two men who left this earth without dying. Chapter 2. The only time in the Old Testament where men are allowed to see God's mounted army of angels, chapter 6. The first mention of the word Jew in the Bible, chapter 16, verse 6. The second of two biblical fables, for the first, Judges 9, 7 through 15. The second, of course, is chapter 14, verse 9 here. The deaths of two of the Old Testament most wicked women, Jezebel, 9:33, and Hezekiah, 14:14. The second Old Testament miracle dealing with the sun, chapter 20, verse 8 through 11. First, we talked about in Joshua 10. The final two of three Old Testament bodily resurrections from the dead, chapter 4 and chapter 13. Book of 2 Kings is the 13th longest Old Testament book and the 16th longest biblical book with 25 chapters, 719 verses, 23,532 words, and every word is important. It is quoted from or alluded to 26 times by 6 New Testament books, and the events cover a period of 293 years. Along with this too, you have 1st and 2nd Chronicles. So we'll begin next time by giving an overview of 1st and 2nd Chronicles, and then we'll get into this and see how it corresponds and relates to one another. Okay. Lord, we love you. We thank you, dear God. Each word in your word is so important, God. Be studied and look upon. It's going to teach us something. And over again, we see some of the same lessons taught. That you're a wonderful God, a gracious and merciful Savior. Lord, that as bad as we mess things up, and tear things up, destroy things, God, you're there to pick us up. You're there to make a way. You're there to save us from all of it. Lord, would you save us? Would you save our lands? Would you send a great revival? Do a mighty work of restoration, God. Would you send the greatest spiritual awakening this world has ever known, dear Lord? And that can only happen by your Spirit moving upon hearts and lives, by people repenting, getting right, knowing the truth and responding to the truth. Help us, Lord, in every word we read, learn that it's truth, it's your truth, dear God, that can change our lives. And we thank you and praise you in Jesus' name.